Hello and welcome to Bentley Baptist Church's Sunday morning live stream. Wherever you are watching this, you are so welcome, and I hope that you're able to connect with God in a meaningful way today. In a few moments' time, we're going to have some worship songs that are going to play and be streamed, and I hope that you can use these to connect with God. After that, Graham, who's one of our elders here at the church, is going to bring this morning's message, this morning's talk, and he's answering the question, is it possible to make a deal with God? Then Jill will be leading us in prayers, asking God to do amazing things to bring hope and peace to our world. Before we dive in this morning, let's just pray. Lord God, we want to meet with you today. Help us to encounter you in a meaningful way. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Me out of darkness, you have filled What do you like at doing deals? When you go to somebody and say, if you can do me this, I'll do you that. Or somebody comes to you and says, can I borrow this? Can you help me with this? And you'll say, yes, as long as you will do that for me at some later stage. It's normally a deal based between equals. I've got something that will benefit you, and you something that would benefit me. So let's do a deal on this. Have you ever tried to do that with God? Yes. God, you sort out this problem that I've got. You sort out this difficulty that I'm in. You make this person better, whether it be yourself or a loved one or somebody else. And God, I promise that I will do that. But you see, we're not really in a position to be able to make those sort of deals with God, because God is the Almighty God. We are His creation. We've nothing to offer Him that would be a benefit to Him. How can we add to God? We can't. But God does make promises to us, and He assures them and confirms them to us. And we're going to have a look at that. See, the Bible uses the word covenant. A covenant is something which is a binding legal agreement which cannot be broken. And we use that probably without realizing sometimes when we say we've got the Old Testament and the New Testament. We've got the Old Covenant, which tells us, yes, about God's law, but also lays out the sacrifices and rituals and the things that we need to observe day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year. And then there's the New Testament or the New Covenant, which speaks about Jesus and having a relationship with God the Father through Him. How it was a new covenant that God made. And He confirmed that with Jesus. You see, a covenant is a binding agreement between two people or between nations. There are pledges made. There's a legal part. I'll do this if you will do that. It's done in front of a witness that is called. And sometimes in the Old Testament, there would be a pile of stones built. They would be having a meal together. They would ask God to be the witness and the judge that they would be able to keep that covenant that had been made. And we can read about one of those in Genesis 31 between Jacob and Laban. Jacob had been looking after Laban's flocks. Laban was his uncle for about 20 some years. He'd married Leah and Rachel, his two daughters, and got grandchildren, but Jacob felt it was time to go back home. Go back and face what he'd left in rather a hurry. And so there was an agreement set up between Jacob and Laban. Jacob put a stone pillar up, and Laban put a pile of rocks around it and said, "Now this is going to be a witness between us." They had a meal together. They pledged not to do one another any harm or any difficulty or any issue. And they called God to be their witness. And you can read a number of these things as you read through different parts of the Old Testament. Covenant is something which is legal and binding and absolute for the people that made it. Nowadays, we have marriage, which is a covenant relationship, where two people, a man and a woman, make a covenant together. And they use words of a vow, which says, "I take you to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, until death parts us. In the presence of God, I make this vow." That's the pledge part. And that is said to each one. The man says it, the woman says it. To one another. In the presence of witnesses. In the presence of God. Asking God to be their witness. And then as a symbol, there's the ring, the wedding ring, which is exchanged and given. It's a reminder of the promises that have been made. Then afterwards, there's the meal, the wedding reception. Very similar and based on principles of covenant making that have been outlined in the Bible. See, making a covenant is a serious business, and it's not to be taken lightly. Just want to read this out of Hebrews chapter 6, which the writer of the Hebrews gives a good example of God's covenant promises to us. For example, there was God's promise to Abraham. Since there was no one greater to swear by, God took an oath in his own name, saying, I will certainly bless you and will multiply your descendants beyond number. Then Abraham waited patiently and received what God had promised. Now, when people take an oath, they call on someone greater than themselves to hold them to it. Without any question, that oath is binding. God also bound himself with an oath so that those who received the promise could be perfectly sure that he would never change his mind. So God has given both his promise and his oath. These two things are unchangeable, but it's impossible for God to lie. Therefore, we who have fled to him for refuge can have great confidence as we hold to the hope that lies before us. This hope is strong and just and a trustworthy anchor for our souls. It leads us through the curtain into God's inner sanctuary. Jesus has already gone in there for us. You see, what the writer of Hebrews is saying is that there isn't anybody greater than God. So his promise, his oath, is that he is believable. He is someone that can be depended upon. We can be perfectly sure God never changes his mind. He does not lie. We can trust in God's covenant promise. Our lives are secure. They're like an anchor that keeps us secure. God makes his covenant to love us and to be with us. Is it because we deserve it? Have we earned it? Or have we been able to do a deal with God to get it? No, not at all. Whatever deals you think you might have done, they will not have fulfilled anything. It's not that we earn it, because I just want to read out of Deuteronomy. And this is Moses speaking to the people of Israel. And he says this, Deuteronomy 7, the Lord did not set his heart on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other nations. You were the smallest of all nations. There was nothing there that was going to be of any benefit for God to say, oh, look at them, they're great, I'm choosing them. Rather, it was simply that the Lord loves you. He was keeping the oath he had sworn to your ancestors. That was to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. That is why the Lord rescued you with such a strong hand from your slavery and from the oppressive hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Understand, therefore, that the Lord your God is indeed God. He is the faithful God who keeps his covenant for 1,000 generations and lavishes his unfailing love on those who love him and obey his commands. But he doesn't hesitate to punish and destroy those who reject him. Therefore, you must obey all these commands, decrees, and regulations I'm giving you today. If you listen to these regulations and faithfully obey them, The Lord your God will keep his covenant of unfailing love with you, as he promised with an oath to your ancestors. You see, it wasn't that these people, this nation of Israel, deserved God's love. It wasn't that they earned God's love. It just said you were insignificant. It was simply that the Lord loves you. And we can take that, because if we know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, then we are God's people. His church is part of God's chosen people. And so we can receive the love of God, because he was keeping his oath, the oath that he promised to Abraham when he said, to you and to your descendants, you will be a blessing forever. And we got that blessing through Jesus Christ. God promised on oath to Abraham that he would bless all nations, all peoples on earth, through his offspring. And we are. You see, he is a faithful God who keeps his covenant for 1,000 generations. It could be up to 20,000 years. What it means is it's forever. God keeps his covenant promise to love us, lavishing his unfailing love as we obey him. But it's not an obedience of ritual. It's not following out of because we have to. It's following because we know God's love upon us, and we love and delight to follow him. Daniel, who was one of the people who had been taken into exile, and as a young lad, and spent 60, 70 years there in exile, but serving that sort of barbaric nation in a way that didn't honour God at all. But Daniel was faithful. And towards the end of his life, he said this: Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. You see, even Daniel, in the midst of difficult circumstances, knew God's covenant love was with him, because Daniel honored God. There's 11 times in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant part of the Bible, where it speaks about God keeping his covenant love. You see, God's intention is to love us. He's committed to us. He's committed to loving us. He's committed to blessing us if we respond to in a right way to him. And this is fulfilled in Jesus, through his life, death, and resurrection, the very presence of God on earth, taking our place, taking our punishment, and allowing us into full and eternal life. So what about us? What's the challenge for me today? God has kept his side of the covenant to love us unconditionally, to make himself present with us. He has provided the sacrifice to confirm that covenant love in Jesus. Over the last 3 weeks, Joel has been helping us to think about something to do with his love. We started off, do you love God with all your heart, soul, mind and strength? Are you faithfully following him, obeying his command to love one another? That is the command, to love your neighbour as you love yourself, to love one another. And then, as we heard last week, are you living life to the full? Are you following Jesus and allowing him to bless you and take you into all the good things that have set you free from what was binding you and holding you? Have you ever responded to God's love? Why not Think about that now. Because God is committed to loving you. Why not ask him to reveal himself to you right now? It may be that we've responded to God's love and become a little weary or distracted. Other things have got in the way. Perhaps it's been difficult for us, particularly over the last year when we haven't been meeting together. We haven't had the same relationships with one another that we perhaps had. Perhaps God isn't as real as he once was for you. God's covenant love for you is still as real as it ever was. Why not turn back to him now? Enjoy his love afresh. As you love him, follow him. And say, Lord, I want to love you more. Let's pray. Just Father God, we just thank you for your love, which is so real. Thank you that you're committed, covenanted to loving us. And as we turn towards you, Father, reveal yourself to us again. May we enter into the fullness of your love. Thank you for being committed to us. Help us to be committed to you in these coming days, weeks and months. Thank you for Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this part of our service where we bring our prayers and requests to our Heavenly Father. Anne posted two verses from Psalm 8 last week, and it's such a powerful psalm and reminds us that our awesome Heavenly Father, creator of the world, loves and cares about us. He hears our prayers, he listens and answers. And in cases you didn't see the verses, this is what they said. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? So we thank you, Father God, that you are creator, ruler over all the heavens and the earth, and you love each one of us with that pure and unconditional love. So this morning we're going to focus our prayers on three things. Bentley Baptist Church, our community, our families. So let us pray together. And Ephesians reminds us that because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your church is here in Bentley. We pray for the food bank. Bless those who are willing to serve you in the food bank. Please help them to continue the work that has already been started. Equip them with all the resources that they need to reach out into the community. Lord, we ask your blessing on our young children in CBBC and the youth, that as many of them are struggling with homeschooling and being stuck indoors, unable to meet with their friends. We pray for those who are anxious about returning to school and ask that you give them peace and that sense of excitement to be meeting their friends again. We ask that each one will know you as their Lord and Saviour, that they will grow in faith as they give their lives to you. We thank you for those who are willing to serve in this ministry and ask that you would bless each one of them with your precious love. There are many in our church, Lord, who are struggling with health issues, and we ask that you would heal them in the precious name of our Lord Jesus. We thank you for all those who have helped in bringing your word to the church during this pandemic. We thank you that we now have a new pastor, and pray for wisdom and vision for the leadership team as they work together to lead your church in Bentley. We pray for Joel and his family as they prepare to come and live in Doncaster. We ask that you would be with them every step of the way and that they will trust in you to provide the right home and the right schools for the children. So we look forward to being able to meet together, Lord, in your church building and being able to sing your praises once again. Lord God, we ask that your church in Bentley be the light in the darkness for all those who are in need. Father God, there are so many people struggling in our community right now during this pandemic. We pray and ask that you would bring hope and peace to those who are lonely, those who are struggling with mental health issues. We pray that you would be compassionate to those who are grieving loved ones, whether through this virus or natural causes. We pray they will reach out to you. Please provide the resources for those who have been affected by the floods and live in fear of the weather forecasts this winter time. We pray for those who have lost jobs and finding things hard financially. We pray for those families living in fear because of abusive relationships and ask that you would protect them. And we pray for those relying on drugs or alcohol to get them through the day. Lord, we pray that you will be their hope and their reason for living. We just give thanks, Lord, for Renew 127, that, Lord, you have placed it in our community, that its doors are open to all those who are in need. We give thanks to those who serve you in this area, Lord, those who are willing to step out into your community to bring your love and your guidance and your support to those who are struggling, Father. But Lord God, you are the great provider, the Jehovah Jireh. So we humbly ask that you provide all that our community needs and reveal to us how we can help to continue to serve you in our community. Lord, you have placed us in families. We thank you that we are loved and cherished by you and that we are able to share that love with our own families. So no matter what our struggles are, Lord, we trust in you because we know that ultimately you are the one that is in control. We all have loved ones who don't know you yet, Lord, and our greatest heart's desire is that they will be saved and have a relationship with you. So Lord, help us, show us how to live our lives each day, Lord, so that our loved ones will see you and want to know you more. And Father God, we bring all these prayers to you in the precious name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus. Amen.
Well, I hope that you have been able to connect with God in a meaningful way this morning, whether it was through the songs, the prayer time, or through Graham's fantastic message this morning. My prayer for you is that because of your encounter with God, your day tomorrow will be filled with peace, hope, love, and a purpose that no one can take away. God bless you, and the Lord be with you. And if you've enjoyed your time with us this morning, please do follow us, subscribe to our channel on YouTube so that you never miss out on one of our Sunday morning services. As I've already said, may God bless you, and the Lord be with you. See you soon.